We found a couple of snap-offs. Brody's standing under them. He's 6 foot. Just to show you how big they are. There's also three bendovers and quakies. I don't know if you, oh, there's four or five. I see two more back there. Ones that they pulled over and may perhaps not broken for them. But these two definitely did. Brody stood under, and we're on our way. We're 4 miles from the location that we were last week. There's three of them. Jenny said there was three, and I didn't see the other one. I don't know if you guys can see it. I found a grove of these on the west side of Bear Lake at a real heavy sighting spot. In my opinion, it's an aggressive male that is in that sighting location that's messing with all of these. So I think it's an alpha male territorial marker. We're on our way to some structures that Brody found back here prospecting, and now we've already found some snap-offs. We're on the Bear Wallow side of Mirror Lake. It was Moon Lake, Yellowstone Canyon we were last week. This is 4 miles away. We're gonna go get the structure and we're gonna put it on GPS. There's three enormous snap-offs and a bunch of bendovers. I take it as an alpha male showing off his destructive power to females and rivals. Left the trail to find the structure. This is Brody's ammo. He's a 20-year prospector and he's been everywhere off trail, and we've wrangled him into joining our group and helping us find structures that he's found in the past that we suspect are Bigfoot related, especially the correlation of the structures to Bigfoot sightings and stuff. We're in a Bigfoot hot spot up. We're hiking in off trail to find a really nice teepee structure Brody found several years ago. And like I said, this is a high activity sighting, and people report hearing vocals out of here. So we're gonna find that structure, hopefully. After we find that structure, we're gonna spread out and see if we can find corresponding structures. We already found a territorial grove of aspens where they snap them as high up as they can, 3, 4, 5 inch saplings. It just shows us strength. It's a big time display. Brody found a teepee ramp type structure. It's been all mangled together here, and most of this deadfall has been relocated to here. You can see how, like, this has been snapped off. It didn't grow here. You know, that's our indicator that it's not something natural when you're looking at the bases of these. And Brody's like, look, this isn't natural. These have been relocated. Every once in a while, you'll find a structure that's close to one of these that's naturally made. Most of these have either fallen or been snapped off and brought here. I'm going to take you guys to the other base. I can see from way back there that this is relocated. This isn't uproot. This just didn't fall right here. It was brought in. And there's the structure. We're 4 miles away from where we got all the activity last week. In here looking for structures, and I found a magnificent one. This one's crazy. It's several structures put together. You got your like east facing teepee structure. It's quite a bit of a ramp. And then you got a great ramp right here. And if you can't tell, this log right here has been relocated. And I've walked around and most of these logs have been relocated, but I believe the bigger ones make some of these ramp type structures because they're heavy and they're old and they don't like getting up in the trees. And the only reason they get up in the trees is because they get up into them and they go about 30 yards in the trees and drop down into their bedding spots. I mean, you guys may think I'm crazy, but I find bedding spots close to these, and so I'm going to be looking around for one of them. There's Brody and Jenny back there. Yeah, we come up to this structure, and did all these trees fall from different angles perfectly in this fork? I think not. I've already found evidence on a lot of the bottoms of these trees. Like, look at this one right here. I mean, that was brought in from somewhere. I think they use some of these heavy-duty ramp structures to get up in the trees so that they can swing in 30, 40 yards to a spot and drop down in bed, and they're not leaving tracks and they're not leaving a scent to where they're bedding down. Juveniles, especially the smaller ones, I doubt they need these structures to get up into the trees. But this right here is I'm naming it a ramp type structure, and it's made on a grand scale. I think this is another corner of its territory. There's a lot of berries here. a lot of berries that stick with berries up here, so there's a great food source. And we all know that the berries are edible right now, and they just start tasting better and getting bigger as it gets into the winter time, and you can eat those all winter long. So I can see why a bunch of sighting reports and a bunch of vocalization reports are starting to come out of this area. Well, starting. They've been coming out of this area, and they have been coming recently. We hiked about 3 miles in here where there's a lot of Bigfoot activity, and Brody's been taking us in, showing us a structure he found back here. We've found close to a dozen suspect structures. We just found a spring up on top, and the spring's right above where there's a lot of loganberries. We're also finding pinyon berries. There's some right here by the water source. I'm gonna zoom in. I mean, there's so much abundant food. Those ones aren't ripe, but the ones down at the bottom of this draw that we come up to get over here, they're all ripe. And then the loganberries are just barely coming into ripeness, and they're going to get bigger and more thick. And as we all know, those will last into the winter time. This is a great food source area. No wonder why we're going to take a break in this spring and be quiet. But yeah, we found a lot of structures, and it's break time because this hike kicked my butt. I don't know if I can call this a draw. We come up kind of a hill in the Rocky Mountains. Anywhere else we come up a mountain, and it overlooks a lake. I don't know if you can see that lake between the trees and stuff, but there's a lake back there. It's a really neat area. We think in a lot of the territorial places that they really mark off, there's female and young and a good food source, and then you have a male that runs around between the structures, because we're finding signs the last several years that the big ones are only in certain areas every once in a while, and you're finding the 14 inch and smaller ones there a lot. So I think the resident male, or the alpha male in the area, has a large territory, and the females have small ones near water sources and food sources, and he comes in and protects them from invading males and marks the areas and stuff. We're going to put this into the GPS system and see if this area is related with the other one.
That's a big paw.
Possibly bear scratches on this big old aspen.
Oh, there's bear poo.
Look at the size of the claws that would have to make this one, you guys. The very bottom one on this aspen. And there's a lot more up here. This is also great habitat for bear. We're up here because of Sasquatch sightings and vocalizations. That this has a strong history of it. But God, it looked like it climbed all the way up to there. But yeah. Brody, will you stand in front of that tree so I can get a perspective of how far these claw marks go up? You know, if it's great habitat for an omnivore like a black bear, why wouldn't it be for Bigfoot if that's what made these? But it was a big bear that did this. This is behind the spring. We think we might be on the other side of the large territory of the alpha male. We're going to take a look around. We're finding a lot of food sources and water sources up here, a spring and two different types of berries. And then we're also finding a lot of structures close to food sources and water sources up here. It's an amazing area. Just found another structure. I heard three whoops in this area and a couple of wood knocks. I think I got one of the whoops on film earlier. Brody's got a mic that keeps running, or a recorder. It's got a better mic than what I'm using right here, so hopefully we got them all. Near where we heard the whoops, and it was whoop whoop. Whoop, whoop. I mean, it was loud and deep and carried a long way. I'm sure we got them. There's one of the major parts of the tree to the structure. You know, I don't see these structures anywhere else I camp, except for when I camp back in heavily sighted Bigfoot areas. But we've hiked about 3 miles back in here, and we've found two sources of water, a creek, and then way up on the top we found a spring. Have you clicked film?
Yep, it's going.
Thank you. All right, we found a bedding spot. We found a more complex bedding spot right behind this. I took a bunch of pictures and also filmed it, but we're back. I'm gonna lay on it. You can tell it's old. And before I lay on it, let's just look at it for hair and whatnot. Just not seeing much right now, but you can tell this was used a while ago, and maybe even recently. There's fresh and old, broken and brought and laid down here. You know, something with the ability to snap and make a nest made this. And I just want to lay down on it. Probably hasn't been used for some time. I don't know, something twice the size of me could lay under this. And I don't know, different situations is pretty comfortable. But we found a lot of food sources. This is a great place for sightings and stuff. We do our research, and we don't waste our time going to places without a lot of sightings. And this is a heavily reported sighting area. Brody, back in his prospecting hunts and stuff, he found a structure back here, so we come back to investigate because it made sense. This is a high traffic area, and we've found you know, maybe a half a dozen to a dozen other structures, two different types of food sources just in berries, and then a spring up on the top, and most of the structures are around that spring, a lot of trail impediments. So anyway, that's an old nest. Be nice to find some hairs in there. I don't see anything right now. I kind of looked before I laid down on it so I wouldn't ruin any of them. The bedding spot, and you can see old and new pine boughs that have been laid down to make it underneath the pine tree. We found this 14-inch footprint, which is concurrent with the resident female, and we measured the width, and the width is a little over 6 inches wide, and at the toes are splayed. She's like splaying them almost like 8 inches, unless it's a young male up here, but I doubt it. And at the hill, the inside of the hill is looks to me like 6 inches or less. That's a pretty definitive print. I really want to cast it. These guys are trying to talk me out of it, and I don't. Brody's up ahead looking to see if we can find a more definitive print, but that's pretty definitive to me, and it's right next to a bedding structure. I don't know if it's been used recently. It definitely has been used in the past. There's fresh and there's old dead pines in here. So something back here has been sleeping, and it leaves a very squatchy footprint. I really want to cast it. Near the bedding spot, back behind all the structures and stuff, we found a 14-inch footprint. We found a few more, but this one's the deepest and stuff. We think it was made when the ground was wet and mud after a rainfall, because it made a bed right here. We were talking about that earlier. A lot of sightings back up here on the Bear Wallow side of Moon Lake. This bed looked like it's been used in the past, maybe possibly recently. There's dead pine boughs with fresh new ones. Looks like a comfortable place to get out of the rain under this pine tree. And then out here we find a print that looks like it was made in the mud in the Rocky Mountains. The soil is really rocky up here. 6 inches wide, nearly 14 inches long. And I hope this dries quick, because it sounds like another thunderstorm is coming in. Brody and Jenny standing by another print that we found that's not as definitive as this one. I'm going to go walk over with them and start checking out other footprints now that we got the casting set. We're going to let that dry. I know it's not perfect. We could really see the outlines of the toes on the edges and stuff. I took some pictures and filmed it and stuff. We'll see how the cast turns out, but yeah, 14 incher. It's either a adult female or a large juvenile male that's still growing. We're gonna go check some other things out. We've heard some whoops and stuff. After getting this deep in here, we really thought we had a non-event trip until we got up past the spring on the top and past the food sources and started finding structures. And now we found some prints, and we've heard some whoops and some rock clacks. And I'm gonna go up ahead and look at these other footprints. Beyond the structures, the bedding spot under the pine tree, and a couple of good 14-inch footprints by that, we come out here, and it's past a spring, and we're finding another spring. This one isn't as much of a pond-type spring as the other one, but there's a lot of grass, vegetation, and water weeds and stuff. And deer hunters have reported seeing Bigfoots actually come out in the open over here in these things and actually eat. One of the few places that people see them out in the open, they'll sit down in one of these places and eat a bunch of this rich spring type vegetation and stuff that grows around and in springs and stuff. A great place, and it's really close to a bedding spot that we found. They must have bed there when it was raining. It looked like it made a footprint in some great Rocky Mountain mud. There's Brody and Jenny back there, but we've found several food sources back in here, including a whole hillside of berries, and this is a second water source up here. I can see some of the freestanding water right out by some of the thick stuff. Great Sasquatch habitat. Not too far from a bedding area where there's two bedding sites. One of them right under a pine tree. It looks like it gets used, or got used more than once. We find a teepee structure. This is actually the structure that Brody brought us up here to see, and we found a lot of structures. Heard some whoops. Found some footprints. It's not heavy activity like last week. We've heard at least four distinct whoop whoops up here. It seems like a real squatchy area, and then we're right above another spring where this one's made. The bedding spot is between both springs. This spring's full of vegetation. The other one's mostly water. It does have vegetation at the edge. There was game earlier. Haven't seen any game right now. They're probably smarter than us. I don't know if you can hear the thunder, but there's a storm rolling in. We're going to be in our ponchos soon. We're waiting during a storm. We put a plastic bag over the cast we made of the 14-incher. Here's a 17-inch print that we found on the other side of the pond. Will you point where we can see the hill, Jenny?
The hill comes right around here.
And then go along the edge, going up to where it busted into. I mean, this took a lot of weight and strength. It really busted into that log
right
with the toes
up
at the front. We don't have enough casting material to cast this 17-incher. You know, that 14-incher was too good to pass up. Don't disturb any of the material, please.
This is the hill.
Oh yeah.
And it goes right down into there, and there's the...
And I'm going to measure the width of this thing too. I want to get it from another angle in case people can't see it. It's a good 17-incher, and it weighed a lot to do this. Let's get it the other direction. All we found up here so far until we found this one is the Cajun-y. I don't know if this will sit level. Oh, sorry. Yeah, it's about 7 inches wide at the widest spot up by the toes. Dang rain. Yeah, it's a big boy. He's about 17 inches in his foot size, and there's a lot of destruction in
his feet.
Structures and snap-offs.
His hill is 5.
He's got a 5-inch hill, and up close to the toe splay, he's got like an 8-inch, and he's 17 inches long. I wished we had enough casting material to do that one. Even if we did, it looks like it's going to downpour. We need to get back to that other one and see if we'd give it enough time. it started to rain, waiting for the print to dry. We put a plastic bag over. It's dry. It's ready to come up, but it's been raining so hard. We've been taking shelter where Bigfoot made this shelter. I think Jenny's getting her poncho. Brody's already got waterproof gear. I've got my cheap poncho on. My jacket's supposed to be water resistant or whatever, but I got my poncho on. But we were staying dry under here, and there was a break in the rain, and we went out to see if we could get it up, and it started up again. So there was supposed to be a 0% chance of rain up here today. Obviously the weatherman's wrong. The Uinta Mountains run opposite direction of the Rockies. The Rockies run north to south, and the Uintas run east to west. They're inside the Rocky Mountains, but because of their position, they get a lot more moisture than most parts of the Rockies. It catches a lot of moisture because the jet stream goes east to west. They capture a lot of it right here. We're gonna get back into the structure, or not the structure, but the bed site. Possible Bigfoot bedding site right by a 14-inch print, and off that way we found a really nice 17-incher. Wish we had more casting material to cast that. We took a lot of pictures and videos. We're gonna get back in here and wait for the rain to subside, hopefully, and go back down. Otherwise, we're gonna have to walk down in it. But I think we can see a clear spot in the sky coming, so hopefully it's blowing over. Alright, I'm recording another structure. We're several hundred yards from where we found three footprints, two 14-inch and a great 17. The best out of the 14s that we were casting before we found the 17-incher that we was letting 14-inch dry. We've backpacked way back in here, and it's been raining on us, and we only had enough material to cast one good sized footprint. It's kind of a disappointment because the 17-inch footprint was even better than the 14 we got. But here's another territorial marker. There's definitely some past and present Bigfoot activity up here. Found a lot of food sources up here, and we found water sources up here on the top by I think it's Bear Wallow. It's where Brody says we're at. It's out by the Moon Lake in Yellowstone Canyon area, and we're finding structures and footprints. We casted a 14-inch footprint. It's been a great adventure. It is the 10th of August. It's actually Jenny's birthday, and she's up here squatching for her birthday. I want to film myself walking through this structure. I've already filmed it once, but you can see that the bottoms that make up this structure have all been snapped off and brought in here, and a couple of existing trees have actually been like leaned into this massive structure. Less than a couple hundred yards where we casted the 14-inch print near a bedding site. It looks like the bedding site's been used more than once recently and several months ago, because there's some of the pine boughs are dead from when it used it in the past. We huddled under there while it rained. It was a great spot to get out of the rain. We threw a garbage bag over the print to let it complete setting up. We already GPS'd it. We're going to add it to our database and overlay it on some maps along with other structures we found up here.
Is that a print?
Okay, in an area where we're finding a lot of footprints and a bedding site of Bigfoot, we even casted one up here, 17 and a 14. The 14 got casted. We measured all the rest of them. There's also some deer or elk scat right there. It looks like a large deer. We found that spot where something sat down and ate some type of a game with feathers. And then there's a separate one. Let me see if I can find it again. I'll turn around. Oh, there's a second one. There's two different spots that a predator brought some game. I mean, I know bobcats, lynxes, lions, even a bear will. Something's favorite spot to have Rocky Mountain chicken. They're probably game hens. They're pretty easy to catch. Even people can catch them just by throwing a club. You can get up close to them. But this is something's favorite place to eat. And we're not too far from a bedding place. There's a great draw right down here that we're heading down into. So right up here in Bear Wallow, Moon Lake, we're finding a lot of food sources and evidence that something's eating up here. And by the way, we found several sets of possible Bigfoot prints moving in and out of this area. There's a lot of activity. We've heard some knocks and some whoops up here, just a few. We've only heard like four or five whoops and probably a half a dozen wood knocks, and I've also heard some couple of rock clacks up here.